Blessed be the God of our salvation.
Who bears our burdens and forgives our sins.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious Father, who blessed Son Jesus Christ came down from heaven to be the true bread which gives life to the world, evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Joshua. The Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have rolled away from you the disgrace of Egypt." So that place is called Gilgal to this day. While the Israelites were camped in Gilgal, they kept the Passover in the evening on the 14th day of the month in the plains of Jericho. On the day after the Passover, on that very day, they ate the produce of the land, unleavened cakes, and parched grain. The manna ceased on the day they ate the produce of the land, and the Israelites no longer had manna. They ate the crops of the land of Canaan that year. Hear what the Spirit is saying.
Thanks be to God.
When the great waters overflow, they shall. from my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble.
You surround me with shouts of deliverance.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. From now on, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Hear what the Spirit is saying.
Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
All the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and said, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So Jesus told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of the property that would belong to me." So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a several famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his field to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough to spare? And here I am, dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. And put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field when he came and approached the house. He heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed a fatted calf, because he's got him back safe and sound.' Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him, but he answered his father, 'Listen, for all these years I've been working like a slave for you and have never disobeyed your command, yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours come back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you kill the fatted calf for him.' Then the father said to him, 'Son, you're always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice because your brother, this brother of yours, was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.' The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. We know this story pretty well, right? The story, the parable of the prodigal son. There was a father with two sons. The younger son asks his father for his inheritance money before his father is dead. Strangely enough, the father agrees and gives the son the money, which was unlawful back in the day, but still happened. The younger son promptly leaves home, which leaves the family with significantly less money and resources, for the son leaves behind the work and responsibilities of the property. He takes the money and leaves his father and his brother to pick up the slack in his absence, and he goes away in a far distant country and blows through his inheritance on dissolute living, whatever that means. But just like that, the son loses everything, even he loses himself. He gets lost because of three bad things. One, bad choices. Two, bad luck. Three, bad company. He's poor, hungry, alone. I mean, he has really hit the rock bottom at this point. And later, we read that he came to himself. This is the fulcrum that determines whether or not the younger son was truly repentant. What exactly does it mean that this man came to himself? Does it mean that he realized his mistakes, felt truly sorry for the harm and worry he has caused, and desired forgiveness? Or does it mean that he simply knew where to get the better meal or the next score? I mean, after all, his father's hired hands were eating better. Did he feel sorry, or did he realize that his dad is a big softy that's just going to take him back, no matter what? Was the younger son really sorry? Did he feel remorse for all the worry and hardship that he put his father and his brother through. And I'm sure he rehearsed the speech multiple times in his head. Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands, please. I often wondered, is that speech legitimately sincere and coming from contrite heart, or is it just a bunch of hot steaming garbage? Is he paying lip service to his dad so that he can take advantage of his wealth once more? But regardless of his intentions, we know that after coming to himself, the younger son concocts a speech to hopefully win himself back into his father's grace. He comes home. And when he comes home from a great distance, his father recognizes him, runs over to him to meet him, and the younger son begins his speech. And the funny thing is, he's cut off before he can even finish it. In an instant, the overjoyed parent hugs the son, kisses him, puts a ring on his finger, throws in a big banquet. Forgiveness, grace, and mercy are given to the son that was thought to be dead. The younger son didn't even have time to finish his lofty speech, showing that it wasn't important to the father whether or not the lost son was truly repentant. The father didn't care how much the son regretted his decisions, how determined he was to never do it again, or if he had plans to try and make it up for the BS he put his family through. The father only cared in the moment of seeing his son once more. All that was required to put this moment of reconciliation, mercy, and joy into motion was for the younger son to come to himself. That's all it was. The son simply remembered what he had forgotten. He remembered who he was. More accurately, he remembered who he was to his parent. He remembered that he was beloved. He was beloved, and that his father would do anything to be with him. It's a classic story of forgiveness and repentance, but the repentance in this story is not a profound sorrow and remorse for sin and a steadfast commitment to do better, but it is simply remembering who we are and whose we are. In the movie Finding Nemo, a clownfish is trying to find his son, who has been taken across the ocean. The father, Marlin, meets another fish named Dory, and Dory suffers from short-term memory. So she quickly forgets what she was doing and why she was doing it. So this is the way that she describes it. I forget things almost instantly. It runs in the family, or I think it does. And in the sequel, Finding Dory, a certain event sparks Dory's memory, and she suddenly remembers where her parents might be. To find her parents, Dory sets a journey across the ocean again. Marlin is reluctant to make the dangerous journey with her. And Dory pleads for her friend's help and asks, "If I forgot you, would you forget me?" Dory is convinced that even though she had forgotten her parents will never forget her. She knows that if she returned home, she will find her parents still waiting for her. Dory remembered who she is and who her loving and faithful parents are. The younger son remembers who he is as a beloved child, and he remembers who his father is as a loving, forgiving, gracious, and generous parent. So he comes home. But when he comes home, his brother is mad. He is fuming that his father will welcome back the one who put them through so much grief and throw a party to such a spoiled, selfish brat. A typical younger sibling behavior, or so I've been told. Now, I don't have any siblings, but I can totally see this happening. and me identifying as the older son. When you have been working so hard and trying your best, it can be rather resentful, as it seems like all your efforts are overlooked and what you have done worthless. But not only is the older son fuming with anger, he refuses to be part of the reunion and celebration. He would rather sulk alone in his own anger than be at a party to a lavish grace and life. Again, totally a behavior I would likely carry. Ironically, the older son who had worked hard, played by the rules, and been a good son is now in danger of becoming lost too. The older son had fallen into the same situation what the younger son fell into when he ran away from home. The older son has forgotten who he is. He has forgotten who his parent is. And his father tries to remind him that everything he has belongs to the older son now. He tries to remind the older son that we have to celebrate. That his brother was lost but is now found, was dead but is now alive. His older son has forgotten who his dad is. He has forgotten how foolishly generous and loving, merciful he is, and unable to rejoice and see life and goodness in things. He even detaches himself from the brother. Rather than saying, this brother of mine, he says, this son of yours. But I think we're all in the same way. In our most difficult moments of our lives, when we're in the danger of becoming lost like other of these brothers, we forget who we are and whose we are. Because we made bad choices, or had bad luck, or kept bad company, or keep count and track of everything to make sure things add up. We want quantifiable love, grace, and justice. Not you or anyone else's value and worth matters, because we are more concerned of what is fair than what is loving and life-giving. We lose ourselves. And yet, we come to this place to hear those promises of God's forgiveness, grace, and mercy over and over and over again. Because we need to be reminded of who we are and whose we are. We come to the table to receive the body and blood of Christ to remember. We come to the waters of baptism, where we are reunited with Christ in his death and resurrection, and plunged into the body of Christ so that we might remember. Remembering that God is the parent who runs with reckless abandon to us when we are lost. In the words of Dr. Lowe's, God loves us fiercely, vulnerably, courageously, and unendingly. Whether we have wasted opportunities after opportunities, or have been working away faithfully and wondering when we will be noticed, whether we have welcomed others who are down and out, or have judged others for not measuring up, God loves us. Whether we are in the church reluctantly, with joy, whether we had a lifelong relationship with God, have come to know God, or aren't even really sure God even exists, God loves us. Whether in person or online, God loves us truly, madly, and deeply. I've always thought what it was like to be the younger son in that moment, walking back to home, being recognized by his dad, seeing his dad running across the field, hugging him, kissing him, showering him with love. I wonder if something triggered, an emotion of that warm care, love, gentleness, safety that he felt when he was a child. On this Sunday, people of God, remember that Creator holds you into a deep, loving embrace. The one who sets a seal upon your hearts, and the one who will welcome you home whenever, however, whatever you arrive. Amen.
We pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For our community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Carly, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers,
for all who serve God in this church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
God of mercy, we pray for Dot Leslie. We commend her spirit that she has joined the church triumph. We continue to pray for River, Karen, Jane, Steve, Greg, Dwight, Frank, Linda, and Ethan.
Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, trusting in thy goodness and thy mercy, that you will hear the cries of your children. We lift up these petitions to you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The peace of God be always with you.
And also with you.
Well, hello and peace to all of you who are here and to everybody watching at home on youtube.com, Christ Church in Short Hills. Today after church, there will be a town hall in the parish hall after a little bit of coffee hour time, and we'll be discussing outreach ministries at Christ Church. There will be a chance to hear about various outreach ministries that we're already involved with, but also to have table conversation, or for those on Zoom, you can have a Zoom conversation about what God might be calling us to consider next. So I encourage you to come and stay for that. On Saturday, we'll have a funeral for Dot Leslie, who passed last week. She would have been 105 in April, and she was very beloved by this congregation, all of her friends at Winchester. And I felt fortunate to see her on Monday and have a really good conversation with her in communion. So she had a long, blessed life that we'll celebrate next Saturday. On the 23rd of April, we'll have a service for Ann Wiss, who died between Christmas and New Year. And then we also have a service for Jane Derrickson on April 30th. It's not in your messenger, but next week will be a Scout Sunday. This used to be a regular thing before the pandemic, that the Scouts, the Cub Scouts and Boy Scouts would come once or twice a year. So we will have Pack One, and Michael Murphy is the new Pack Master, and also Troop 15, and they will be with us next Sunday. Coming up, we will be reading the second half of the book, The Last Week, by Borg and Crossan. It's really excellent, about Jesus's last week of life, if you want to join us on April 5th. And also, if you know anybody who's interested in the Christ Church Nursery School director position, those applications are due April 5th also. Holy Week is coming up, April 10 to 17. The schedule is in the bulletin and the messenger, and we'll have more detail. But I encourage you to come to as many of those services as you can. We're sort of returning to our 2019 model of services. We are adding in a Good Friday Stations of the Cross service outside at 3 p.m. on Good Friday, and Mary Frances Schonberg will be our preacher at the vigil. There are other announcements in the messenger, and I just want to say a personal word. I was in my office typing up the announcements when somebody walked by, and out of my peripheral vision, I thought it was somebody who I haven't seen in church for a while. So I came out to try to find them and realized it was somebody else, who I was also happy to see. And I just want to say that for those of you at home who are watching now or watching later, we miss you. And I hope you'll consider coming back, looking out. There are people here who have been regulars, people who are new since the pandemic, people who haven't been for a while and have come back. And we're not going to make you feel guilty. In fact, when people come back, I have often noticed that they are a little teary-eyed. They've missed church, and everybody has missed them, and their friends are happy to see them. So I just want to encourage you, as we come into Holy Week and the spring, if you're watching at home, please consider coming back in person. We do miss you.
Birthdays and anniversaries. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries this week? It's the birthday? Okay. I'm going to say a birthday prayer for John, but also please keep him in your prayers. He's having hip replacement surgery on Monday, and keep his doctor in your prayers too. Dear God, we thank you for John, for the gift of his life and his energy and the passion he brings to everything he does. Thank you for blessing him with his wife and his family, with work and with health. Lord, continue to be with him today, tomorrow, and always, that you may hold him and guide him and bring him back to church recovered in a couple of months. God bless. Amen. Amen. I also want to share that John and Paul Funk have agreed to step in as our new co-head ushers. Scott Chastain was our head usher for 7 years, including through a couple of really difficult years of innovation during the pandemic. So he has asked to step down from that position, and I really celebrate his contribution, and I'm very grateful to John and Paul for agreeing to become our new head ushers. This Lent, we are asking people to make contributions to ERD, either to their relief efforts in the Ukraine or to their development efforts through the 1,000 Days of Love campaign. You can make an offering in the back of the church or online at christchurchshorthills.org. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts.
Oh, saving victory.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer to you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as your Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
of God for the people of God. All are welcome at Christ's table. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us in the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. There's a wideness in God's mercy like the wideness of the sea. There's a kindness in his justice which is more than liberty. There is welcome for the sinner and more graces for the good. There is mercy with the Savior. There is healing in his blood. May the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now, remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.
about.